like I've made mistakes and I've changed my thoughts on certain things, you know, through the years. We all do, hopefully, you know, we grow, we learn. But there've been a few things that I just go, man, this is, I know is true. And I'm more sure of it now. And just thinking, okay, you guys have to know this stuff. You guys, this morning is a little different. As you guys know, we're going to Asia in February in a couple months. And kind of like with most of the things in my life, like I don't know how long it's going to be for. Like it might be days, it might be months, it could be the rest of our lives. And then people ask, like, well, you know, are you getting excited? Are you planning? Are you? And I'm like, I'm not even really thinking about it. I just kind of get this sense, like, that's what God wants. And also with the way things are in Asia, so many different things are unstable right now that I go, you know, what I don't want to do is think too far ahead. I don't want to, like, look back with regrets and go, man, I was so thinking about 3-4 months from now that I didn't even take the opportunity right now to say everything I want to say to you guys. And so my mind's been spinning like, okay, what if I had 20 or 30 minutes and this was my last message to you guys, what would I say? Because, okay, like I've made mistakes and I've changed my thoughts on certain things, you know, through the years. We all do, hopefully. You know, we grow, we learn, but there've been a few things that I just go, man, this is, I know is true, has been true from the beginning, and I've not wavered, and I'm more sure of it now, and just thinking, okay, you guys have to know this stuff. Because the world is changing, too. Like, I'm 52, and I've seen, like, just the thoughts and the way people are, so much has changed over these years. And I just want to share, like, from 40 years of studying this book, what has been so true and so clear in this book. Because I guess my concern is, like, you guys are going to be taught so many things that just aren't true. So many lies, you know, in Matthew chapter 7, Verse 13, it says, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. He goes, there's a wide gate, so there's a wide way that's easy. So the easiest thing to do is what everyone's doing. Just know, like, whatever's popular and whatever everyone's doing, like, just remember what the Bible says, that there's this wide road that leads to destruction, and it's easy. So if you're going to take the easy path will always lead to destruction. But he says there's a narrow road. It's like going uphill. It's difficult the way we live, and very few people are going to find that kind of life. And I just see that in the world, like so much of the teaching that is everywhere is just whatever feels good to you, which is the easiest thing to believe. I just do whatever I feel like doing. But you got to remember, like, that is the number one command of the satanic Bible, is do whatever you want. Do whatever feels good. Do what you desire. Do as thou wilt. You know, it's what Satan told Eve in the garden, right? Come on, you want it, just take it, just do it. If you feel like doing it, do it. And I just think you're going to have so many people pressure you into the wide road. That's why the Bible says Satan is the god of this world. Like, there's just a flow of things. And if you just go with popular opinion, it's going to lead you to destruction. Don't listen to it. Don't go down that road. The scary thing as Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy 4, he says, in the last days, people will not put up with sound doctrine, sound teaching. He's talking about in the church. And this is what scares me, is in the church, some of that worldly teaching of that do what you feel is moving into the church. And now pastors that want to keep everyone coming to their gatherings will start changing their theology and go, well, that's not really sin. That's not sin. That's not sin. And the Bible says in the last days, I just want to read it directly because he's so clear. He says, the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions. It's like, well, I want this to be true. I want to sleep with whoever I want to sleep with. Okay, let me find a teacher that'll tell me that. I want to divorce my wife. I'll find a teacher to tell me that. I want to believe that God is weak and that I'm going to talk him into how I'm a good person. They'll find a teacher to tell them that. I want to believe that I'm a good person and that I'm going to go to heaven based on, well, then they'll find a teacher to do that. He goes, but they're not going to put up with this, what this book teaches. But he tells Timothy, but you keep teaching this book. And that's why today I just want to tell you, like, this is what this book says, despite what anyone says. This is what it says. One of the things that's so popular today is people go, well, that's your view of God. You see God in that way, and I see him differently. I'm glad it works for you. You hear that a lot in San Francisco, right? That's great that you found God a certain way. I see him differently, and I really just think that God is, you know, whatever you want him to be, as long as you're sincere and you believe in your heart. So I don't judge you, you don't judge me. But that doesn't make any sense. You know, like just to say that God is whatever you think he is, or, you know, like you believe in your heart. That's like, you know, me saying, gosh, I think Zach is a 500 pound, you know, Hispanic, 6'10", and I believe that in my heart, you know. And Tim goes, well, in my heart, I believe that Zach is a, 5'2" white guy, you know. And it's like, okay, well, we're both right. You know, like that doesn't make any sense. Like, no, he is who he is, right? Remember what God said to Moses when Moses like, what's your name? Who are you? And God says, I am who I am. And the Bible describes him, and it's very clear. And I believe from what the Bible teaches, God is way more terrifying than everyone in the world is going to tell you he is. Way more. If you would just read this book, God is always showing, like, you have no idea what I am like. I mean, think about it. That's why the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. If you don't fear God, you have issues. You got to remember, like when Moses saw God, he said, I was shaking uncontrollably. When Isaiah, this is a prophet, Isaiah saw God, and there were these angels covering themselves up, you know, and they're screaming out his holiness, and there's fire and smoke, and Isaiah just says, I'm dead. He was so terrified. When Isaiah saw God, he thought God was going to kill him, and he was terrified. When John, the beloved apostle, saw Jesus, after Jesus died and rose again, he saw Jesus, and he said, his face was like the sun. His eyes, they were like fire. His tongue was like a sword. And he goes, the moment I saw Jesus, he said, he fell over like a dead man. It just seemed like he was like so terrified. Yeah, like he just collapsed. And so these people in their minds may have thought that God was going to look a certain way, but it doesn't matter. It's not like you come to the end of your life and whatever you thought to be true is true. God says, I am who I am. I love what Job says in Job 42. He goes, my ears had heard of you, But now my eyes see you and I hate myself. Like Job was questioning God on some things. And Job, you gotta remember, Job was the most righteous person on the earth. And even him, when he began to question God a little bit, at the end he goes, gosh, God, I'd always heard of you. And now that I see you, I hate myself and I repent. I'm so sorry. So if this is how Moses encountered God, this is how Isaiah, this is how John, this is how Job, this is how everyone in the Bible sees him, who are we to think that you're going to be the first person, you're going to be the first person in history to come before God and go, oh, hey, God, I'm a good... No, we're all going to see him this way. This is the way God is. He's not like you. He's not like us. He is holy. Okay? I've been teaching Hebrews 12 lately after we read Hebrews this year, and how he says in verse 18, you have not come to what can be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. Okay, this is our God. He's not someone you can touch. He's not like this chair. He's not like Lisa. He's not like Silas. I can touch them. He goes, no, God's like a blazing fire. You can't touch him. And he uses words like gloom and darkness and a tempest, like a tornado. He says, this is your God. And that's why everyone that saw him just like fell over, fell at his feet, and were just blown away. You are going to face that God. We all are. And you have to keep that in mind. Like this stuff, whether I live or die, who cares? Like this is all like temporary stuff. We're going to face God and we are going to be judged by him. And I know it's very popular now. And I've been hearing it more and more every year of my life. People say, well, if God is a loving God, he's not going to punish us. And I'm going, man, have you read this book? Did you read what we read in Deuteronomy this week? That was crazy what God said he would do to those people in judgment. And in Deuteronomy 28? Man, it was so intense what he was saying, how I almost don't even want to read it. It's so intense. I'm just going to read it. You know, Deuteronomy 28:53, he's just talking about his wrath upon these people. Okay, first in 58, he says, if you're not careful to do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that you may fear this glorious and awesome name, the Lord your God, then the Lord will bring on you and your offspring extraordinary afflictions severe and lasting, and sickness grievous and lasting. Earlier in verse 53, he says, you'll eat the fruit of your womb, the flesh of your sons and daughters, whom the Lord your God has given you, in the siege and in distress, which your enemies shall distress you. The man who is the most tender and refined among you will begrudge food to his brother, to the wife he embraces, and to the last of the children whom he has left, so that he will not give any of them the flesh of his children whom he is eating, because he has nothing else left in the siege and the distress with which your enemy shall distress you in all your towns. The most tender and refined woman among you who would not venture to set the sole of her foot on the ground because she's so delicate and tender will begrudge to the husband she embraces, to her son and her daughter, her afterbirth that comes from between her feet and her children whom she bears, because lacking everything, she'll eat them secretly. I mean, it's just like gross. Like God's like, you want to feel my wrath? Here's my wrath. You find the most delicate, tender woman, and you know she's gonna just turn into a beast. She'll eat her own kids and in secret. Like you're going, I'm reading this, going, God, could you make it any more disgusting, more intense. Like God is speaking to let us know, you don't mess with me. Like, I am a God of wrath. And yet everyone says, well, if he's a loving God, how could he judge? No, if he's also a God of anger, a God of wrath, a God of judgment. The whole book is culminating in Revelation where he says there's this great white throne judgment where he judges everything and he opens up the books and just goes, look, I know what you did. And it just shows everything you've done in life. Now, by the grace of God, we escape that, those of us who are in Christ, but I'm getting ahead of ourselves. We have to, you need to know, because I know like at school or whatever else, everyone just kind of talks like there's no fear of God. They just do what they want to do. No one's thinking I'm going to be judged by him one day. And I'm telling you guys, I promise you, there's going to be a day of judgment and you are going to stand before that God. And like Hebrews 10 says this, if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the evidence of two or three witnesses. How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. Okay, that's what the Bible says. You want to keep going on in your sin after hearing the truth, there's not going to be a sacrifice for you. But he goes, instead, there's going to be this fury of fire, this wrath of God, and it's a terrifying thing. He goes, man, what I read from Deuteronomy, he goes, that's Old Testament. He goes, if God was that severe about the law of Moses in the Old Testament, how much more severe will he be? So we read Old Testament, and this was a lie I was told so much of my life, like, well, that was Old Testament. And what Hebrews is saying, no, yeah, that was Old Testament. That's light compared to what's coming. And think about the judgment if we don't take the forgiveness that's before us. Okay, so if you never hear from me again, know what I've known my whole life since becoming a believer, since reading this book, is yes, God is absolutely a God to be feared and like no one else, and that he is going to judge, everyone in this room is going to be judged by him, period. Even the whole world will tell you the opposite. But here's the crazy thing is what this book teaches is God wants to forgive you and he wants to know you. Like that, okay, this is why we call this the good news or the gospel. It's like that being who's that whirlwind, you know, that tornado, the darkness, the gloom that you can't even touch because he's this blazing fire and he's this judge that's coming with all of his wrath. Like he wants, like right now, he wants to be my greatest lover. Like he wants to totally be in a love relationship with me, with you. Like he wants that. And this was hard for me to believe. Like, because you guys know, I never had that from a dad that wanted me. So it was weird to think, wait, he wants me? Like, I don't even know what. It took me years to like really believe this and accept it, to go, he wants to be one with me. Ephesians 2, it says that you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. So the Bible says that all of us, we used to just do whatever we want to do, just like the rest of the world. He says, by nature, we were like just following the devil. Like when you do whatever you want to do, you're just following the devil. And he says, you were by nature objects or children of wrath. So that means you were this creation that God was going to pour all of his judgment out on. He says, but God, being rich in mercy. Okay, you guys know what mercy is. Like mercy means like you deserve all this wrath. But God says, I don't want to punish you. I'm actually rich in it. That's in his nature. Like he just want, like that's great news. I mean, because he could have just ended there. Like he's this judge, he's this God, you know, but he says he has this mercy where he wants to forgive all of us. And he proved that by the cross. That's the whole idea of the cross, was in order to be fair, he made Jesus take all of our sins on the cross. So Jesus took all of our sin on the cross so that, he says, that we could become his righteousness. Like this is how amazing he is. Like he wants to forgive you. Like that's his desire. And it's because of his mercy and his great love. Okay, again, this is where I didn't understand this for a long time. That's what motivated the cross. For God so loved the world. Like, why? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And I guess when I was thinking about what would I really want to say to the kids, like if it's the last thing, I think it's mainly that, like, I want you to know that, let's not just know these things about God, but I want you to know him. Like for example, like let's say I died today. I don't really have to worry about, you know, you guys being taken care of because mom would be here. And you know mom, right? It's not like you only know mom because you knew me and I would tell you about mom, right? You know her directly. And it's got to be that way with God. Like, it can't just be like, I know God because my dad knows God and God has shown that he's walked with my dad his whole life. Like, you have to know him, you know? And I want to, like, if it was the end of my life, I'd want to just know, it's no big deal. They know Lisa. They know God. They don't need me. You've got direct relationship, you know? You have direct relationship with God. And the verse that I think about is, in Philippians 2, we read this a few weeks ago, and I'll just close with this. He says, therefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. So Paul says to this church, he goes, look, you guys always obeyed when I was there. But now that I'm gone, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. So in other words, it's like, okay, you guys have been great kids when I'm here and we talk about God, we pray, we worship Him. But he says, if I'm gone, the idea is now you work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Like, you work out your own salvation. This can't be like you guys through me or living precarious, you know, just kind of like living through me. And so I just picture like wanting to leave with total peace, you know, the country. And the only way I can have total peace is knowing that it's not that you just believe a bunch of stuff about God. Okay, I've told you truths. It's not just about believing those truths and those facts. And I think sometimes we make Christianity all about believing certain things about God. But this book is about being known by Him. You know, that's why they say, like, so many people, when they turn 18, walk away from their faith. Because their faith is like a bunch of beliefs. It's like it's just like, I don't believe this and these things anymore. Because you can walk away from a belief system. You can't walk away from a person. Like, you can't walk away from me. You can walk away from beliefs, but you can't walk away from your dad. Why? Because your dad's going to come after you and I'll find you, you know? And in the same way, it's like, we in the Christian world, we sometimes talk about Christianity like it's a set of beliefs that you agree to or you don't, and that's like the end of it. And it's like, no, those are just truths that get us to this relationship of knowing Him. And once you know Him as your Father, He goes, I'm not going to let you go. Like, you're grounded, you're in love with me. That's why, like Heather, like the moment you started believing, it was just so clear, like, she loves Him. Like, you would talk about Him as your lover. And I'm like, gosh, I went to school with so many people that know this book backwards and forwards, but I just go, gosh, do you know Him? And that's why I don't want you guys to ever just go, yes, I believe that Jesus was the Son of God, and He died on the cross, and He paid for my sins. He became, it's not just that. It's like relationship, like knowing me. And again, like that verse says, though, you've got to work it out on your own, but you work it out with fear and trembling, and it's God who works in and through you. And if you don't have that, if you go, gosh, that's not in me, like, I only tend to obey whenever mom's around or dad's around or my husband's around or that, whatever it may be, and it's not coming from inside, and you don't have this life and this joy from knowing Him, man, I'm praying that you'll hear what I'm saying and that it'll get you thinking. But more, I've been praying for you specifically, because the Bible says that something happens to those of us who believe. Like, there's a moment when the Holy Spirit opens up your eyes and you go, I get it. And you don't have to tell me. I want Him. You know, like those first believers in Acts 2, when they heard the message, they're like, what do I need to do? Where do I sign up? And He says, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the Holy Spirit of God. And it's like, okay, that's everything. Repent, be baptized, and filled with the Spirit. You don't just casually shrug your shoulders and go, all right, I believe that. If that's you, then you don't get it. And Jesus says, you've got to deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. Jesus demands that we follow Him. And if you don't think it's worth it, If he's not worth it to you, then you don't get it. And again, the world is like saying, well, God can't give me these desires and tell me I can't fulfill them. No, that was his exact message. You need to deny yourself, even to the point of picking up a cross to be crucified next to me and follow me. And if you're not willing to do that, you can't be my disciple. Like, he wants to be Lord of our lives. So it's just this crazy, amazing, like, you can spend the rest of your life trying to figure out, gosh, he's so powerful, and yet he wants to be intimate with me, one with me. It's by grace that I'm saved, but I'm saved when I understand how beautiful he is and surrender everything to him. Like, all of it is true. And there's a truth that the Holy Spirit enters you and changes you completely, but there's a side in which I've got to let the Holy Spirit and ask the Holy Spirit and follow the Holy Spirit and make every effort towards this holiness by the power of the Holy Spirit. And all I know is, like, you know, Mom and I told the story of last year at our 25-year anniversary about how, you know, at dinner she just goes, do you know of anyone more blessed than we are? And I go, no. Like, seriously, I don't know of anyone more blessed than we are, but it's not because we have an awesome family. It's not because of success. It's not because money. It really is because I know God. It's like, this has been so crazy. I've spent a lifetime talking to God and he answers me and we know each other and I'm loved by God. And that's what's made this life amazing for me. And as great as the family is, as great as ministry, whatever, life, it's like knowing him. It's just like in the Bible where all those people, it says, whatever he touched prospered because God was with him. And I just want that to be true of you guys.